Get out of your mind and into your life. The New Acceptance and Commitment Therapy by Stephen C. Hayes, Ph.D. with Spencer Smith. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Copyright 2005 by Stephen C. Hayes and Spencer Smith. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with New Harbinger Publications, Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Publisher's Note: this audiobook is packaged with bonus material, which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please refer to www.tantor.com, keyword, Get Out of Your Mind and Into Your Life. Click on PDF Extra 1. This audiobook contains interactive exercises. If you wish to participate in these exercises, you may want to have paper and pen nearby while you listen. Introduction. People suffer. It's not just that they have pain. Suffering is much more than that. Human beings struggle with the forms of psychological pain they have. Their difficult emotions and thoughts, their unpleasant memories, and their unwanted urges and sensations. They think about them, worry about them, resent them, anticipate and dread them. At the same time, human beings demonstrate enormous courage, deep compassion, and a remarkable ability to move ahead even with the most difficult personal histories. Knowing they can be hurt, humans still love others. Knowing they will die, humans still care about the future. Facing the draw of meaninglessness, humans still embrace ideals. At times, humans are fully alive, present, and committed. This book is about how to move from suffering to engagement with life. Rather than waiting to win the internal struggle with your own self so that your life can begin, this book is about living now and living fully with, not in spite of, your past, with your memories, with your fears, and with your sadness. Act. What it is and how it can help you. This book is based on acceptance and commitment therapy, or ACT. This is a new scientifically based psychotherapeutic modality that is part of what is being called the third wave in behavioral and cognitive therapy. ACT is based on relational frame theory, RFT, a basic research program on how the human mind works. This research suggests that many of the tools we use to solve problems lead us into the traps that create suffering. To put it bluntly, human beings are playing a rigged game in which the human mind itself, a wonderful tool for mastering the environment, has been turned on its host. Perhaps you've noticed that some of your most difficult problems have paradoxically become more entrenched and unmanageable, even as you've implemented ideas about how to solve them. This is not an illusion. This results from your own logical mind being asked to do what it was never designed to do. Suffering is one result. This may seem like a very odd claim, particularly if you picked up this book to help yourself overcome some of your psychological issues. As a rule, people turn to self-help books for tools to solve specific problems: depression, anxiety, substance abuse, trauma, stress, burnout, chronic pain, smoking, to name just a few. For the average person, overcoming these problems implies not just an ultimate end, but also an end reached by specific means. For example, overcoming stress seemingly must first involve eliminating stressful feelings. Overcoming smoking seemingly must first involve getting rid of urges to smoke. Overcoming anxiety disorders seemingly must involve learning how to relax instead. or to dispute and change overblown and worrisome thoughts, and so on. In this book, ends and means are carefully distinguished, and you will learn that many of these common sense routes to a better life are now thought to be both risky and unnecessary in current psychological theory. If you are suffering with a psychological problem, you should know that research suggests that ACT helps with many common psychological difficulties, and its underlying model has received considerable support. We will discuss these data throughout this book. The fact that you are listening to an empirically based account is all the more important because this book will take some seemingly strange twists and turns. At times, it may be confusing. To some degree, that is unavoidable because ACT challenges some of the most culturally ingrained forms of conventional thinking about human problems. Research indicates that ACT's methods and ideas are generally sound, which provides reassurance that these concepts and procedures are effective. See the appendix for a partial list of studies on ACT and its components. That doesn't mean they are easy to grasp. Then again, if these ideas and methods were already well known to you, this book would probably not be useful. Here's a sample of some of the unconventional concepts you will be asked to consider. Psychological pain is normal, it is important, and everyone has it. You cannot deliberately get rid of your psychological pain, although you can take steps to avoid increasing it artificially. Pain and suffering are two different states of being. You don't have to identify with your suffering. Accepting your pain is a step toward ridding yourself of your suffering. You can live a life you value, beginning right now. But to do that, you will have to learn how to get out of your mind and into your life. Ultimately, what ACT asks of you is a fundamental change in perspective, a shift in the way you deal with your personal experience. We can't promise that this will quickly change what your depression, anger, anxiety, stress, or low self-esteem looks like, at least not anytime soon. We can, however, say that our research has demonstrated that the role of these problems as barriers to living can be changed, and sometimes changed quite rapidly. The ACT methods provide new ways to approach difficult psychological issues. These new approaches can change the actual substance of your psychological problems and the impact they have on your life. Metaphysically, the distinction between the function of a psychological disorder and the form it takes in one's life can be likened to someone standing in a battlefield fighting a war. The war is not going well. The person fights harder and harder. Losing is a devastating option, but unless the war is won, the person fighting it thinks that living a worthwhile life will be impossible. So the war goes on. Unknown to that person, however, is the fact that at any time, he or she can quit the battlefield and begin to live life now. The war may still go on, and the battlefield may still be visible. The terrain may look very much as it did while the fighting was happening. But the outcome of the war is no longer very important, and the seemingly logical sequence of having to win the war before beginning to really live has been abandoned. This metaphor is intended to illustrate the difference between the appearance of psychological problems and their true substance. In this metaphor, the war looks and sounds much the same whether you are fighting it or simply watching it. Its appearance stays the same, but its impact, its actual substance, is profoundly different. Fighting for your life is not the same as living your life. Ironically, our research suggests that when the substance changes, the appearance may change as well. When fighters leave the battlefield and let the war take care of itself, it may even subside. As the old slogan from the 1960s put it, "What if they fought a war and nobody came?" Compare this metaphor with your own emotional life. ACT focuses on the substance, not the appearance, of problems. Learning to approach your distress in a fundamentally different way can quickly change the impact it has on your life. Even if the appearance of distressing feelings or thoughts does not change, and who knows, it might. If you follow the methods described in this book, it is far likelier that the substance of your psychological distress, that is, its impact, will change. In that sense, this is not a traditional self-help book. We aren't going to help you win the war with your own pain by using new theories. We are going to help you leave the battle that is raging inside your own mind and to begin to live the kind of life you truly want. Now. Suffering. Psychological quicksand. This counterintuitive idea of abandoning the battlefield rather than winning the war may sound strange, and implementing it will require a lot of new learning. But it is not crazy. You know about other situations like this. They are unusual, but not unknown. Suppose you came across someone standing in the middle of a pool of quicksand. No ropes or tree branches are available to reach the person. The only way you can help is by communicating with him or her. The person is shouting, "Help! Get me out!" and is beginning to do what people usually do when they are stuck in something they fear. Struggle to get out. When people step into something they want to get out of, be it a briar patch or a mud puddle, 99.9% of the time, the effective action to take is to walk, run, step, hop, or jump out of trouble. This is not so with quicksand. To step out of something, it is necessary to lift one foot and move the other foot forward. When dealing with quicksand, that's a very bad idea. When one foot is lifted, all of the trapped person's weight rests on only half of the surface area it formerly occupied. This means the downward pressure instantly doubles. In addition, the suction of the quicksand around the foot being lifted provides more downward pressure on the other foot. Only one result can take place. The person will sink deeper into the quicksand. As you watch the person stuck in the quicksand, you see this process begin to unfold. Is there anything you can shout out that will help? If you understood how quicksand works, you would yell at the person to stop struggling and try to lie flat, spread eagle, to maximize contact with the surface of the pool. In that position, the person probably won't sink and might be able to log roll to safety. Since the person is trying to get out of the quicksand, it is extremely counterintuitive to maximize body contact with it. Someone struggling to get out of the mud may never realize that the wiser and safer action to take would be to get with the mud. Our lives can be very much like this, except the quicksand we find ourselves in often is, in one sense, endless. Exactly when will the quicksand of a traumatic memory completely vanish? At what moment will the painful quicksand of past criticism from parents or peers disappear? Right now, think of a psychological aspect of yourself that you like the least. Take a moment to consider this question. Now ask yourself, was this an issue for me last month, 6 months ago, a year ago, 5 years ago? Exactly how old is this problem? Most people find that their deepest worries are not about recent events. Their deepest worries have been lurking in the background for years, often many years. That fact suggests that normal problem-solving methods are unlikely to be successful. If they could succeed, why haven't they worked after all these years of trying? Indeed, the very longevity of most psychological struggles suggests that normal problem-solving methods may themselves be part of the problem, just as trying to get free is a huge problem for someone stuck in quicksand. You've picked up this book for a reason. Our guess is that you find yourself in some sort of psychological quicksand and you think you need help freeing yourself. You've tried various solutions without success. You've been struggling, you've been sinking, and you've been suffering. Your pain will be an informative ally on the path that lies ahead. You have an opportunity that someone who hasn't experienced psychological pain doesn't have, because it is only when common sense solutions fail us that we become open to the counterintuitive solutions of psychological pain that modern psychological science can provide. As you become more aware of how the human mind works, particularly your mind, perhaps you will be ready to take the path less traveled. Haven't you suffered enough? We haven't written this book to help you free yourself from the quicksand you find yourself in, but to get with it. We wrote to relieve your suffering and empower you to lead a valued, meaningful, dignified human life. Psychological issues that you've previously struggled with may technically remain, or they may not. But what will it matter if they remain in a form that no longer interferes with you living your life to the fullest? The ubiquity of human suffering. This book starts from a different set of assumptions than most popular psychology books do. We indicated what that difference is in the first two words of this introduction. People suffer. We don't assume that, left to their own devices, normal human beings are happy, and that only an odd history or a broken biology disturbs the peace. We assume instead that suffering is normal, and it is the unusual person who learns how to create peace of mind. Why this is so is a puzzle. This book is about that puzzle. It's remarkable how many problems human beings have that non-humans can literally not imagine. Consider the data on suicide. It occurs in every human population, and serious struggles with suicide are shockingly commonplace. Throughout your lifetime, you have about a 50-50 chance of struggling with suicidal thoughts at a moderate to severe level for at least 2 weeks. Almost 100% of all the people on the planet will at some point in their life contemplate killing themselves. Pre-verbal children do not make suicide attempts, but even very young, newly verbal children occasionally do. Yet we have little reason to believe that any non-human animals deliberately kill themselves. That basic pattern repeats itself in problem area after problem area. Most human beings struggle, even in the midst of what appear to be successful lives. Ask yourself this question. How many people do you know really well who don't experience periods in which they struggle with serious psychological or social problems, relationship issues, problems at work, anxiety, depression, anger, self-control issues, sexual problems, fear of death, and so on? For most people, a list of such contented acquaintances will be very short indeed, perhaps even empty. The scientific data on human problems confirms this impression. Let's just mention a few random facts. About 30% of all adults have a major psychiatric disorder at any given point in time. About 50% will have such a disorder at some point in their lives, and nearly 80% of these will have more than one serious psychological problem. Americans spend huge sums of money in their efforts to alleviate their psychological pain. For example, antidepressants are a $10 billion industry, even though their average impact on depression is only 20% better than a placebo. Too small to be clinically significant. Indeed, our consumption of antidepressants is so high that our rivers and streams have become polluted with them, contaminating the fish we eat. But these statistics, sad though they are, grossly underestimate the extent of the problem. When people are given open access to mental health care, only about half of those who seek help are diagnosed with a serious mental health disorder. The other half are having problems at work, or in their marriages, or with their children. Or they suffer from the lack of purpose in their lives, what the philosophers call existential dread, or from angst, which is a strong, ever-present feeling of apprehension and anxiety. Marriages, for example, are probably the most important voluntary adult relationship most humans enter into. Yet about 50% of all marriages end in divorce, and remarriages are no better. The dismal statistics on fidelity, abuse, and marital happiness show that many intact marriages are based on unhealthy relationships. This litany could go on and on easily. By the time all of the major behavioral problems human beings face are added together, in effect, it is abnormal not to experience significant psychological struggles. How can this be? We could understand it if we were discussing people without resources in ravaged societies. If a Sudanese child must hide from the violence of a rebel militia, we can easily appreciate her misery. If a grieving mother in Indonesia loses everything to a tsunami, her suffering is horrible, but, given her horrific circumstances, it is to be expected. This is mostly not true for the people who listen to this book. As most of us realize when we compare our lives to the lives of those suffering from war or horrendous natural disasters. Yet in many problem areas, people who are intelligent and successful are not necessarily happier than their less fortunate counterparts in other parts of the world. People who live in countries with spectacularly successful economies do not have fewer social or interpersonal problems, for example, suicide, than their counterparts in more difficult economic circumstances. How can this be? Apply this question to your own life. Isn't it true that the things you are struggling with and trying to change tend to persist even though you are competent and able in so many other areas of your life? Isn't it true that you've tried to solve these problems but so far have failed to find a real solution? Indeed, you may have already tried many solutions, and yet, here you are buying another book designed to help you. How can this be? We ask you to keep these questions in mind as you listen to this book. Why is human suffering so pervasive? Why is yours so difficult to change? And what can you do about it? The rest of this book will explore these questions in detail. We think we can supply at least part of the answers. We don't ask these questions from an arrogant or critical perspective. This book won't blame you for your troubles, conveying the not-so-subtle message that your life would be fine if only you tried harder. This book comes from a stance of compassion and identification. It has emerged from our own struggles and those of our patients. These questions are those we've asked ourselves, sometimes from the depth of despair. We believe that science has begun to provide an unexpected answer, however, and it is one that can be directly helpful to you. Mindfulness, acceptance, and values. ACT is not a set of idiomatic phrases or wise sayings that will lead you toward a personal revelation. Although some of the principles in ACT are as old as history, there is one major component of the therapy that is new. ACT is based on a new model of human cognition. This model underlies the specific techniques presented in this book, which are designed to help you change your approach to your problems and the direction in which your life has been going. These techniques fall into three broad categories: mindfulness, acceptance, and values-based living. Mindfulness. Mindfulness is a way of observing your experience that has been practiced in the East through various forms of meditation for centuries. Recent research in Western psychology has proven that practicing mindfulness can have notable psychological benefits. In fact, mindfulness is currently being adopted as a means of enhancing treatment in a number of different psychological traditions in the West. A large part of our approach has to do with mindfulness. What ACT brings to this ancient set of practices is a model of the key components of mindfulness and a set of new methods to change these components. Weeks, months, or years of meditation, helpful as they can be, are not the only practices that can increase mindfulness. And in today's busy world, new means are needed to augment those that evolved in another, slower millennium. In this book, we will help you learn to see your thoughts in a new way. Thoughts are like lenses through which we look at our world. We all have a tendency to cling to our particular lens and allow it to dictate how we interpret our experiences, even to the point of dictating who we think we are. If you are now stuck in the lens of your psychological pain, you may say things to yourself like, "I'm depressed." In this book, we will help you see the dangers of holding on to thoughts of that kind, and we will provide concrete methods to help you avoid those dangers. As you free yourself from the illusions of language, you will learn to become more aware of the many verbal lenses that emerge every day, and yet not be defined by any one of them. You will learn how to undermine your attachment to a particular cognitive lens in favor of a more holistic model of self-awareness. Using specific techniques, you will learn to look at your pain rather than seeing the world from the vantage point of your pain. When you do that, you will find there are many other things to do with the present moment besides trying to regulate its psychological content. Acceptance. ACT draws a clear distinction between pain and suffering. Because of the nature of human language, when we encounter a problem, our general tendency is to figure out how to fix it. We try to get out of the quicksand. In the outside world, this is very effective 99.9% of the time. Being able to figure out how to rid ourselves of undesirable events such as predation, cold, pests, or flooding was essential in establishing the human race as the dominant species on our planet. It is an unfortunate consequence of the way our minds work, however, that we try to use this same fix-it mentality when it comes to understanding our internal experiences. When we encounter painful content within ourselves, we want to do what we always do, fix it up and sort it out so that we can get rid of it. The truth of the matter, as you have likely experienced, is that our internal lives are not at all like external events. For one thing, humans live in history, and time moves in only one direction, not two. Psychological pain has a history, and at least in that aspect, it is not a matter of getting rid of it. It is more a matter of how we deal with it and move forward. The acceptance in acceptance and commitment therapy is based on the notion that, as a rule, trying to get rid of your pain only amplifies it, entangles you further in it, and transforms it into something traumatic. Meanwhile, living your life is pushed to the side. The alternative we will teach in this book is a bit dangerous to say out loud because, right now, it is likely to be misunderstood. But the alternative is to accept it. Acceptance, in the sense it is used here, is not nihilistic self-defeat. Neither is it tolerating and putting up with your pain. It is very, very different than that. Those heavy, sad, dark forms of acceptance are almost the exact opposite of the active, vital embrace of the moment that we mean. Most of us have had little or no training in active forms of acceptance, so we suggest that you thank your mind for whatever it says this term might mean, but don't try to do anything with it right now. This is hard to describe, and learning to be willing to have and live your own experience is something we will focus on quite a bit later in the book. In the meantime, we ask for your patience and openness, and a bit of skepticism about what your mind might right now be guessing we mean. Commitment and values-based living. Are you living the life you want to live right now? Is your life focused on what is most meaningful to you? Is the way you live your life characterized by vitality and engagement, or by the weight of your problems? When we are caught in a struggle with psychological problems, we often put life on hold, believing that our pain needs to lessen before we can really begin to live again. But what if you could have your life be about what you want it to be about right now, starting this moment? We don't ask you to believe that this is so, but merely to be open to the possibility it is so. Open enough that you are willing to work with this book. Getting in touch with the life you want to live and learning how to bring your dreams to life in the present isn't easy, because your mind, like all human minds, will spring trap after trap, throw up barrier after barrier. In chapters 1 to 10, you will learn how to free yourself from those traps and how to dissolve those barriers. In chapters 11 to 13, we will discuss what you really want your life to be about, and we will show you how to complete the process of shifting from useless mental management to life engagement. At this point, we aren't asking you to agree with any of the claims being made or for you to say you understand any of the methods we have just begun to describe. We ask only for your engagement with a journey fundamentally focused on the puzzle of your suffering and that of others. This journey seeks a fundamental change in the very game being played, not just a new strategy for winning it. ACT is not a panacea, but the scientific results are both broad and positive. We believe that we can help you take advantage of this new knowledge. By all means, bring your skepticism, even your cynicism, along for the ride. They will not be harmful, provided you are willing to apply the methods you will learn, even to that skepticism and cynicism. And bring your hopes and ability to believe along as well, although they will not necessarily be helpful until they too are considered from the point of view of the methods to be described. You are a whole person, and all of your experiences, thoughts, feelings, bodily sensations, and behavioral predispositions are welcome to come along on this journey of discovery. What do you have to lose? Wouldn't it be a good thing if you could get out of your mind and into your life? Chapter 1. Human Suffering. You've probably selected this book for this reason. You are hurting, and you're not sure what to do about it. Perhaps you've been suffering from a chronic depression or an anxiety disorder. Perhaps a struggle with drug abuse or alcohol has been costing you your life in your futile attempt to numb your pain. Perhaps a relationship is stumbling, or you are wondering whether life itself matters. It may be that you've been in and out of therapy trying to cope with your inner turmoil. Or perhaps you're one of the millions who just feels stuck, not vital and engaged in life, but distant, deadened, numbed, or overwhelmed. If you've been struggling for some time, you've probably plagued yourself with different forms of the why question. Why can't I just get over it? Why can't I feel better? Why is life so hard? Why hasn't therapy worked? Why can't I be a normal person? Why can't I be happy? You may feel victimized somehow by questions that seem not to have any ready answers. Cornered by your own emotional pain and your struggle with it, you may feel as if your life is narrowing in around you. If you've been fighting a war inside your head, what would it be like if instead of trying to win that war, you knew a way to step out of it? This doesn't mean that the war would stop. It may continue. Rather, It means that you would no longer try to live inside a war zone, with your psychological survival seemingly dependent on the outcome of the war. What if that were possible? This book invites you to examine your perspective not only on what psychological pain is and how it operates, but on the very nature of your consciousness, even your identity. That is, who you take yourself to be. No issue is too basic if it seems necessary to address it. The concepts and methods you will find here may shake you up a bit. Initially, some may be hard to swallow and may even fly in the face of what you've been taught are the solutions to your problems. We have three requests to ask of you. The first is for you to agree to persistent, active engagement with the text. At times, it may be a bumpy ride. We ask only that you stick with it and really try the methods we will put on the table. There may be something here for you, but you will not know if that is so unless you learn and use the concepts and methods before you try to evaluate their actual impact on your life. The second request is to ask for unrelenting honesty from you. We don't ask you to believe what we've written here. We do ask you to look directly at your experience, without blinking. Use this book as an opportunity to explore what is really true for you. For the moment, put aside what others expect, what the world around you demands, what you've long been told is true, or even what your own mind tells you, if it contradicts what your direct experience suggests. Since we can't actually be there as you try out these methods, you will need to rely on your own experience to know whether the approach described here is helpful to you in the long run. There is a growing base of empirical support for the basic concepts discussed here, and some of the methods have been evaluated in laboratory studies presented outside of a therapeutic relationship, using written or oral presentations of these ideas and exercises, much as you might encounter them in this book. Today, there is enough scientific evidence that we believe this is the time to introduce these ideas and methods to the public. But your experience is the actual bottom line. Our third request concerns your intention. We ask that you intend this book to make a difference in your life. You don't have to believe that it will. Rather, we ask you to remain open to that possibility by answering yes to this next question. While you are learning and trying out these methods, if you see in your actual experience the possibility of using them to transform your life for the better, will you be willing to move forward in that direction? If your answer is yes, we are ready to begin. If it is not, remember, be honest. It would be worthwhile to know how deep your resistance to change may be, and it would be worth considering whether such a resistance is in your best interest. Before we begin, we think that a bit of consumer education may be in order. ACT is a part of a school of clinical psychology that is committed to delivering treatment methods based in science. If you have a significant area of difficulty and you haven't undergone a well-planned course of therapy with a behavioral therapist, cognitive behavioral therapist, or other professional who used methods supported by scientific research, you should seek that out. In that instance, this book can be used as an adjunct to a course of therapy with a therapist who understands this approach. A growing base of scientific evidence supports the use of these methods in a psychotherapy context. Human suffering is universal. Often, many people we meet in our daily lives seem to have it all. They seem happy. They look satisfied with their lives. You've probably had the experience of walking down the street when you're having a particularly bad day, and you've looked around and thought, "Why can't I just be happy like everyone around me?" They don't suffer from chronic pain or depression or a substance abuse problem. They don't feel as if a dark cloud is always looming over their heads. They don't suffer the way I suffer. Why can't I be like them? Here's the secret. They do, and you are. We all have pain. All human beings, if they live long enough, have felt or will feel the devastation of losing someone they love. Every person has felt or will feel physical pain. Everybody has felt sadness, shame, anxiety, fear, and loss. We all have memories that are embarrassing, humiliating, or shameful. We all carry painful, hidden secrets. We tend to put on shiny, happy faces, pretending that everything is okay and that life is all good. But it isn't, and it can't be. To be human is to feel pain in ways that are orders of magnitude more pervasive than what the other creatures on planet Earth feel. If you kick a dog, it will yelp and run away. If you kick it regularly, any signs of your arrival eventually will produce fear and avoidance behavior in the dog by means of the process called conditioning. But so long as you are out of the picture and are not likely to arrive, the dog is unlikely to feel or show significant anxiety. People are quite different. As young as 16 months or even earlier, human infants learn that if an object has a name, the name refers to the object. Relations that verbal humans learn in one direction, they derive in two directions. Over the past 25 years, researchers have tried to demonstrate the same behavior in other animal species, with very limited and questionable success so far. This makes a huge difference in the lives people live as compared to animals. The capacity for language puts human beings in a special position. Simply saying a word invokes the object that is named. Try it out. Umbrella. What did you think of when you heard that word? All right, that one's pretty harmless. But consider what this means if the named object was fearful. Anything that reminded the person of its name would evoke fear. It would be as if all the dog needs to feel fear is not an actual kick, but the thought of being kicked. That is exactly the situation you are in. This is exactly the situation all humans are in with language. Here is an example. Take a moment now to think of the most shameful thing you have ever done. Take a moment to actually do this. What did you just feel? It's very likely that as soon as you heard the sentence, you felt some sense of either fear or resistance. You may have tried to dismiss the request. However, if you paused and actually tried to do what we asked, you probably began to feel a sense of shame while you remembered a scene from your past and your actions in it. Because relations that verbal humans learn in one direction, they derive in two, they have the capacity to treat anything as a symbol for something else. The etymology of symbol means to throw back as the same. And because you are reacting to the sounds in this audiobook symbolically, the words you just heard evoked a reaction from you. Perhaps they even reminded you of a shameful event from your past. Where could you go so that this kind of relation could not take place? The dog knows how to avoid pain, avoid you and your foot. But how can a person avoid pain if, anytime, anywhere, pain can be brought to mind by anything related to that pain? The situation is actually worse than that. Not only can we not avoid pain by avoiding painful situations, the dog's method, pleasurable situations also might evoke pain. Suppose someone very dear to you recently died, and today you see one of the most beautiful sunsets you have ever seen. What will you think? For human beings, avoiding situational cues for psychological pain is unlikely to succeed in eliminating difficult feelings, because all that is needed to bring them to mind is an arbitrary cue that evokes the right verbal relations. This example of a sunset demonstrates the process. A sunset can evoke a verbal history. It is beautiful, and beautiful things are things you want to share with others. You cannot share this sunset with your dear friend. And there you are, feeling sad at the very moment you see something beautiful. The problem is that the cues that evoke verbal relations can be almost anything. The ink on paper that made up the word shame, or a sunset that reminded you of your recent loss. In desperation, humans try to take a very logical action. They start trying to avoid pain itself. Unfortunately, as we will discuss in some detail throughout the rest of this book, some methods of avoiding pain are pathological in and of themselves. For example, dissociation or illegal drug use may temporarily reduce pain, but it will come back stronger than ever and further damage will be caused. Denial and learned numbness will reduce pain, but they will soon cause far more pain than they take away. The constant possibility of psychological pain is a challenging burden that we all need to face. It is like the elephant in the living room that no one ever mentions. This doesn't mean that you must resign yourself to trudging through your life suffering. Pain and suffering are very different. We believe that there is a way to change your relationship to pain and then live a good life, perhaps a great life, even though you are a human being whose memory and verbal skills keep the possibility of pain just an instant away. The approach we will explore in this book is suggested by the word suffering. The primary root of suffer is the Latin fieri, which means to bear or carry. The English word fieri comes from the same root. The prefix suff is a version of sub, and in this usage means from below, up, hence away. In other words, suffering doesn't just involve having something to carry. It also involves moving away. The word suffer connotes the idea that there is a burden you are unwilling or unable to carry, perhaps because it seems too heavy, too unfair, or it just seems beyond you. That connotation refers to more than pain alone. In fact, it provides a different way to address the problem of pain. Exercise: Your Suffering Inventory. We would like you to write down a list of all of the issues that are currently psychologically difficult for you. Do not write about purely external or situational events, independent of your reactions to them. In this book, we will focus on how you react. Some of your psychological issues will be clearly related to specific situations, others may not be. For example, my boss would not be a good example of a difficult issue you experience, but getting frustrated with my boss or feeling put down by my boss might be. This list can include any of your thoughts, feelings, memories, urges, bodily sensations, habits, or behavioral predispositions that may distress you, either alone or in combination with external events. Don't overthink it. Just write down what plagues you and causes you pain. Be honest and thorough and create your suffering inventory. After you've completed your list, go back and think about how long these issues have been a problem for you. Write that down as well. Now, we would like to ask you to organize this list. First, go back and rank these items in terms of the impact that they have on your life. Then, write down the same items, but rank them in order. The order should range from those items that cause you the most pain and difficulty in your life to those that cause you the least trouble. You will use this list as a guide throughout the remainder of this book. We'll ask you to refer back to this list as your touchstone for the events and issues that cause you pain. Finally, in the area of the right of this list, draw arrows between every item on the list that is related to another item. You will know that two items are related if changes in one might alter another. For example, Suppose one of your items is self-criticism and another is depression. If you think the two are related, that is, the more self-critical you are, the more likely you are to feel depressed, or vice versa, draw a two-headed arrow between self-criticism and depression. You may find that this area becomes cluttered with arrows. That's fine. There is no right or wrong way to do this. If everything is related, it's important to know that. If some items relate to only a few others, that is useful information too. The higher on your list the items are, and the more other items they connect to, the more important they become. This may suggest a re-ranking of your problems, and you may find that you now want to combine some items or to divide them into smaller units. If that is so, you can create a final working list, ranked from highest to lowest in order of impact on your life. This is your personal suffering list. For you, it is what this book is about. The Problem with Pain. Psychological pain hurts, by definition. But it does more than that. Often, pain holds you back from living the kind of life you want to live. There is no question that a person with a panic disorder would rather not experience the feeling of extreme fear because it is so unpleasant. But that discomfort is compounded by the fact that the panic seemingly gets in the way of living itself. If you have a panic disorder, you may have begun feeling too afraid to engage in the activities you normally would because of your fear that you might panic. It may be that you no longer go to the supermarket because you are afraid you might have a panic attack there. Perhaps you are uncomfortable in social situations because you don't want anyone to see you panic. You cultivate friends with whom you feel safe, but then you are dependent on their schedules and availability. You start to live your life in ways to accommodate your problem, and as a result, your life becomes narrower and narrower, less and less flexible. It is worth noting how much of the pain we feel is a focus of attention because it seems to interfere with other activities. One way to get at this core issue is to imagine how your life would be different if your pain went away. Imagine that someone has waved a magic wand over you and your pain has vanished. Imagine that you wake up one morning and suddenly, for no reason at all, the chronic depression you've suffered from all these years, or the anxiety, or worry, or whatever your core struggles may be, is gone. The cloud has lifted and the pain is over. What would you do? This question isn't a rhetorical one. We mean it literally. What would you do? What would you want your life to be about? How has your current psychological struggle interfered with your goals and aspirations? Let's explore that in the following exercise. Exercise. The pain is gone. Now what? We would like you to fill in the blanks in the following sentences. If blank weren't such a problem for me, I would blank. If I didn't have blank, I would blank. First, let us describe how to do that. Take an item from your suffering inventory. It could be any item, but it might be best to start with an item high on your list and connected to other items. This is probably an issue that greatly inhibits your life. Go ahead and fill in your problem, but don't fill in what you would do if it were gone. Now, think about what you would do if that pain were suddenly lifted. The point of this exercise is not to think about what you might like to do on a given day if your problems weren't plaguing you. The idea isn't to celebrate by saying, "My depression is gone, I'm going to Disneyland." The point is to think more broadly about how your life course would change if your constant struggle with emotional pain was no longer an issue. Don't worry if you think that you don't have a good grip on this yet. We will do a whole lot more work on these issues later in the book. Just go with your gut instinct. Somewhere within yourself, you have some idea about the things that really matter to you. Concentrate on those. Here are three examples to give you an idea of what we mean. If anger weren't such a problem for me, I would have more intimate relationships. If I didn't have so much stress, I would work harder at my career, and I would try to find the job I always dreamed of having. If I wasn't so anxious, I would travel and participate more fully in life. Now, go back and complete the part about what you would do if your pain disappeared. Be honest with yourself and think about what you really want. Think about what has value to you. Think about what gives your life meaning. Now, let's do that again, but this time, let's use a different area of suffering, although it certainly wouldn't hurt to do this exercise with all of the items on your suffering inventory. This time, choose an item that appears to affect a different area of your life than the first one you chose. Although, after thinking about them, you may find that they are not as different as they seem to be. The problem with pain, revisited. You've just discovered that all of your problems provide you with two sources of pain. It is not just your anxiety or depression or worry that creates pain. Your pain is also holding you back from having the life you want to lead. There are activities you would be engaged in if it weren't for your pain and the role it has played in your life. The problem you wrote down in the previous exercises refers to the pain of presence, issues that are present that you would prefer to go away. Social anxiety might be an example of the pain of presence. The anxiety you feel on social occasions is real and present in the moment you feel it. You may wish it would go away. Nonetheless, it persists in the face of your best efforts to defeat it. This is the pain of presence. Those activities you would engage in, if matters changed, represent a different kind of pain. They are called the pain of absence. As an example, consider the same socially phobic person. Perhaps this person truly values engaging with other people, but their fear keeps them from doing so in ways that are meaningful. The connection with others that is so yearned for is not there. This is the pain of absence. You have pain on top of pain, suffering on top of suffering. Not only must you deal with the immediate pain of your thoughts, feelings, and physical ailments, you must also deal with the pain caused by the fact that your pain prevents you from living the kind of life you want to live. Now, see if this next sentence is true for you. Generally, the more you live your life trying to ward off the pain of presence, the more pain you get, particularly in the form of the pain of absence. Remember, we asked for honesty and openness about your own experience. Even if it doesn't seem logical that this should be so, look and see if it isn't true. While you focused more on getting rid of the pain of presence, you've been feeling more of the pain of absence. If that's what's been happening for you, it may feel as though life is closing in around you. It may feel as though you're in some kind of trap. If you've been experiencing these kinds of feelings, then this book is about finding a way out. There's an alternative to living as though you've been trapped. Living a valued life, an alternative. Often, we attach ourselves to our pain, and we start to judge our lives based on how we feel and not on what we do. In a way, we become our pain. The answers you've filled in as your responses to the four sentences in the two previous exercises contain the seeds of another kind of life, a life in which what you do is connected not to your pain or to the avoidance of your pain, but to the kind of life you truly want to live. This book is not about solving your problems in a traditional way, so much as it is about changing the direction of your life, so that your life is more about what you value. Moreover, the unnecessary amplification of pain stops. When that happens, the issues you've been struggling with will begin to diminish. Your life will begin to open up and become more wide-ranging, more flexible, and more meaningful. We ask you to allow the possibility of living a life you value to be your guide as you listen to these chapters and work with the exercises. We aren't asking you to go out and lead a different life right this minute. There is a lot of work to do first. None of this will be easy, because the traps our minds set for us will continue to be laid. In our work on acceptance and commitment therapy, ACT, we've developed a set of processes that appear to empower the people who work with these processes, to improve their lives, and to dismantle troublesome traps and dead ends. Gradually, step by step, we will walk you through those processes in the service of living a vital, valued, meaningful life. If you are willing, let's begin. Chapter 2. Why Language Leads to Suffering. What is the human mind? Why are we different than the birds flying outside our windows, and why do we suffer so? These kinds of questions have puzzled humankind for eons. We think we have some answers, and we think those answers may inform the process you will go through while you work with this book. The Nature of Human Language. As we noted in the introduction, ACT is based on relational frame theory. The basic premise of RFT is that human behavior is governed largely through networks of mutual relations called relational frames. These relations form the core of human language and cognition and allow us to learn without requiring direct experience. For example, a cat won't touch a hot stove twice, but it needs to touch it at least once to get the hint. A human child need never touch a hot stove to be taught verbally that it can burn. In the outside world, this ability is a tool beyond compare. But in terms of our inner lives, verbal rules can restrict our lives in fundamental ways. We set out 20 years ago to try to discover the core features of human thinking. Today, we think that we've isolated some of the key components. Perhaps it's too risky to say it so boldly, but we think we've found what is at the core of the human mind itself. Humans think relationally. Non-humans apparently do not. Exactly what this means will become evident in this chapter, but in broad terms, humans are able to arbitrarily relate objects in our environment, thoughts, feelings, behavioral predispositions, actions, basically anything, to other objects in our environment, thoughts, feelings, basically anything else, in virtually any possible way. For example, same as, similar to, better than, opposite of, part of, cause of, and so on. This characteristic is essential to the way the human mind functions, because it is our key evolutionary asset and has permitted the human species a dominant role in the animal kingdom. The ability to think relationally allows us to consciously analyze our environment, develop tools, build fires, create art, make computers, and even do our taxes. This same ability creates suffering. The idea isn't entirely new. Often, the words about language were once metaphors, and their etymology focuses on that relational core. One word mentioned in the last chapter, the word symbol, comes from the ancient Greek root ball, which means to throw, combined with sim, which means the same. A symbol literally means thrown as the same. When our minds throw words at us, Those words appear to be much the same as the things to which they refer. The etymology of refer completes the picture. Do you remember we discussed the root of fur in Chapter 1 when we explored the word suffering? Fur means to carry, hence the word fairy, and re means again. So, to refer to something involves carrying something again. This early common sense understanding corresponds to our research findings about the nature of human thinking. When we think, we arbitrarily relate events. Symbols carry back objects and events because they are related to these events as being the same. These symbols enter into a vast relational network that our mind generates and expands on over the course of our lives. What follows is a brief list of relational frames. This is not at all comprehensive. Such a list could fill pages, and isn't important to understand the parts of RFT that are necessary for the work we are about to do. Relational frames. Frames of coordination, such as same as, similar, or like. Temporal or causal frames. These include before and after, if then, cause of, parent of, and so on. Comparative and evaluative frames. A whole family of relations, such as better than, bigger than, faster than, prettier than, and so on. Deictic frames. These are frames with references to the perspective of a speaker, such as I, you, or here, there. Spatial frames, such as near, far. It is this repertoire, this set of learned relations that can be applied at your whim to anything at all, that we mean when we refer to the human mind. Exercise. Relate anything to anything else. You can test the idea that you develop arbitrary relationships all the time quite easily. To do so, try the following. Write down a concrete noun. Any type of object or animal will do. Now, write another concrete noun. Now answer this question. How is the first noun like the second one? When you have a good answer, go on to this next question. How is the first noun better than the second one? When you have a good answer, go on to this question. How is the first one the parent of the second one? Finding an answer to this final question may not be straightforward. Stick with it. It will come. That last question may have been the hardest, but if you do stick with it, you will always find an answer. And note that the good answers somehow seem to be real in the sense that the relation you see seems to be actually in or justified by the related objects. That is, they often seem to be not arbitrary at all. This exercise demonstrates that the mind can relate anything to anything in any possible way. In technical terms, it suggests that relational responding is arbitrarily applicable. This fact is hidden from view because the mind justifies these relations by features it abstracts from the related facts. As you can see from this silly exercise, that cannot be wholly true. It cannot be that, in fact, everything actually can be the parent of everything else. Yet your mind can always find a justification for that relation, or any other. We will apply this insight to the story of your life in Chapter 7. Even human babies can do it. Even very young human babies can use these relational sets quite naturally, but non-humans arguably do not. In this area, even the so-called language-trained chimpanzees fail the tests a human infant would easily pass. For example, suppose a baby learned that a particular imaginary animal had a name and that this animal made a sound. We might show the baby a drawing of our imaginary creature and say, "This is a gub-gub. Can you say gub-gub?" After the baby learns this, we might show the same picture to her and say, "This goes woo. Can you go woo?" In this example, we have three pieces of relational network: the picture, the name of the animal the picture represents, gub-gub, and the sound that animal makes, woo. The relationships between the fictional creature, its sound, and the picture could be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.